Jovian Whistlers from Jupiter, listener.
Hey, friends. Don't touch that dead bird. Britney Spears' Milk Production Facility Repair Guide Hour is coming up right now. Hey everybody, welcome back to the Britney Spears Milk Production Facility Repair Guide Hour. I'm your host, Britney Spears. Today's topic is Oops, I Did It Again. I've dropped my cell phone or smartwatch into the pasteurizer or homogenizer. I am very excited to discuss this relevant subject today, as I've received so many emails over the past few weeks from listeners going haywire over this all-too-common pitfall of milk production. Britney, I've dropped my cell phone into the pasteurizer. Britney, I've dropped my smartwatch into the homogenizer. I know you did. Before we start troubleshooting, as always, let's take a few calls. Lobster One, you're on the air.
Hi, Brittany. I'm calling from Anchorage, Alaska.
Oh, wow. I didn't know they had lobsters in Alaska.
I'm a human.
I was just up at the Havemeister Dairy in Palmer last year. If I'm not mistaken, that's maybe 45 minutes from Anchorage.
Well, that's right.
Why did you call me a lobster before? Hard to believe Havemeister is the sole remaining dairy in the entire state of Alaska ever since Northern Lights Dairy and Delta Junction closed last year.
Very sad.
What's your question?
My question is, your debut album, Baby One More Time, sold over 20 million copies worldwide. When you were riding that first wave of fame, Britney Spears, is it for real? Is it true? One time you got so drunk you asked MTV production assistant Don Dundle to be your lawfully wed.
Okay, we're gonna have to end that call right there. Sorry, folks. Some lobsters don't seem to get that this is a podcast about Britney Spears, the certified milk production technician. Not Britney Spears, the famous pop singer. Yes, my debut album did sell over 20 million copies. Yes, that's a lot of records for a 17-year-old gal from Louisiana. But that was a long time ago. Almost as long ago as the Milk and Milk Products Act of 1947, which lays down provisions regulating the sanitary, sterilization, or pasteurization requirement affecting the production of raw milk for pasteurization. Pop quiz, loyal listeners. What is pasteurization? That's right. Pasteurization is a process in which packaged and non-packaged foods, such as milk and fruit juice, are treated with mild heat to eliminate pathogens and extend shelf life. The process is intended to reduce spoilage organisms and eliminate vegetative bacteria, but not bacterial spores. Pasteurization generally occurs at temperatures less than 100 degrees Celsius or 212 degrees Fahrenheit for you Americans out there, and is used widely in the dairy industry and other food processing industries to achieve food preservation and food safety, my two favorite things. Pasteurization was named after the French scientist Louis Pasteur. whose research in the 1880s demonstrated that thermal processing would inactivate unwanted microorganisms in wine. Pasteurization inactivates spoilage enzymes. Pasteurization applies heat using plate heat exchanger and/or direct or indirect use of steam and hot water. Due to the mild heat, pasteurization causes minor changes to the nutritional quality of foods, as well as their sensory characteristics. A small price to pay for healthy, safe milk, if you ask me. Listeners, have you ever cast prudence to the wind and tried unpasteurized milk? The horrors. Call in with your craziest stories. As for your old gal Brittany here, I almost drank unpasteurized once. Okay. I was young. It was the 90s. In fact, it was 1999, and I was on tour with, well, I won't say who they are. It's nice to maintain some mystery in these H1N1 times. But here's what happened. We had a couple days off in France. Our road manager took us to a restaurant called Le Café de l'Opéra Brouhaha. In English, that's Raw Milk Café. I mean, hello, can you spell danger? D-A-N-G-E-R. At the time, I was about 2 semesters into my correspondence coursework in dairy science. So I knew all about the dangers of raw milk, brucellosis, listeria, salmonella. But everyone else was doing it. Stupid, Brittany, stupid. And you know how hard peer pressure can be, especially on an 18-year-old girl who's been homeschooled her whole life and just wants to fit in. So, against my better judgment, I ordered a glass of the rawest milk in France. Yes, that's right, the rawest milk in France. It had been in the cow's mammary glands that morning, and had probably only been filtered through some old cheesecloth or something. I could practically see the pathogens. They were singing to me, taunting me. Well, here goes nothing, I thought. I pinched my nose shut, closed my eyes, tilted the glass to my lips, closed my eyes again, when suddenly a page from my Introduction to Dairy Science textbook flashed against the darkness of my eyelids, which, as I mentioned before, had been closed twice. And before the milk could reach my lips, I set the glass down and apologized. Everybody laughed at me for an hour. But the laugh was on them, haha, because they drank unpasteurized milk, and they could have come down with food poisoning, and we might have had to cancel the remaining leg of the tour. Pasteurization works, people. Okay. Lobster number 2. You're live. What's up?
This is Don Dundle. I thought we were gonna get married. You said...
So sorry, folks. The lobsters are really out there today. We need to get Jordan Peterson in here to clean them up. Let's try again. Lobster 3. You're on the Britney Spears Milk Production Facility Repair Guide Hour.
Brittany, on your third album, you tried to break the bubblegum image you had established with the first two. Your music became harder and your lyrics had references to adulthood and sexuality. My question is, was this your decision alone? Or was it something your record company forced on you? What did your parents think?
Sir, I have no idea what this has to do with drinking raw milk. Wow, getting a lot of crazies here today. Let's hope Lobster 4 has something relevant to say. Lobster 4, you're on the air.
Hey, Brittany. Barbara Rockingham from Montpelier, Vermont. I've drunken raw milk on several occasions.
Oh my God, Barbara, are you for real, girl?
Yes, and I loved it. I don't know what all the fuss is about. It tastes better than pasteurized milk. It has more vitamins and minerals. The only problem is it's so expensive, and I live on fixed income. If I had more money, I would drink raw milk every day. Nothing bad ever happened to me, other than World War II. So it's safe.
Well, that's where you're wrong, Mrs. Rockingham. It's not safe. You happen to get lucky for 80 years. But I am glad you experienced no ill effects. That would be not good. Thanks for calling. Now, back to the topic of today's broadcast.
you've dropped your cell phone or smartwatch into the pasteurizer or homogenizer. This is usually a simple fix, but addressing any aspect of milk production facility repair requires understanding the basic layout of a milk production factory or facility. There are generally six or more rooms, each of which may be as large as a football field or small as a kitchen, depending on the size of the dairy and the daily milk output required thereof. They are the receiving room, the pasteurization room, the homogenization room, the bottle washing room, the cold room, and the utility room. It doesn't matter whether they are different rooms or distinct areas of the same room. The end result is the same. Safe, high-quality American market milk, packed, shipped, and ready for American citizen consumption. Milk is delivered to the receiving room. After it comes out of the cow, of course. Use of the receiving room helps keep flies out of the rest of the plant. From there, milk enters the pasteurization room, where the heart of the production facility performs its most vital work, sterilization of milk by the pasteurizer. After pasteurization, the newly safe milk enters the homogenization room, where arguably the second most vital work of milk is performed. Homogenizing. That's right, don't want that clumpy milk. Ding, 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 another pop quiz, friends. Homogenization, what is it? I just gave it away, but let's still ask anyway. That's right! The purpose of homogenization is to reduce the size of fat globules in the milk in order to reduce or prevent creaming. Homogenization may be total or partial. For our purposes, let's assume you work at a partial homogenization factory or facility. Partial homogenization allows for the use of a smaller homogenizer and simpler extraction method for your cell phone or smartwatch, which has fallen into the process line and become stuck, obstructing the milk. To tell you the truth, dear lobsters, I prefer non-homogenized milk. Yes, I know I just said I don't like clunky milk, but, well, I lied. It's milk the way my grandparents enjoyed it. There's nothing like popping open an old-timey bottle of milk where the cream has risen to the lip of the glass, and you skim the cream with your tongue, and it's so heavenly you forget all about your troubles with the dairy industry. Homogenized milk is great, don't get me wrong, but it's just not the same. What do you think, lobsters? Call in and tell me your opinion. Is milk the old-fashioned way better, or do you prefer the new milk? Stay tuned. That was Soccer Mommy with some milk-friendly music. And now, a word from our sponsors.
Yeah, hey, bud, listen up there. Just hang a Hank's paint. This is Chuck of Chuck's Trucks. I want to let you know your prescription has been filled. Come on down to the alley. I'll take off all my clothes and I'll give you medicine in a bottle. A bottle being my fists, which I will insert deep into your mouth. I don't care. I don't give a goddamn if you're 5 years my senior, or if you have Parkinson's. That just means you're more fun to hit. I'm gonna bring you down to Chinatown, beat you up, and take you to my mom's house for dinner.
Looks like we've got another lobster on the line right now.
I love your show, Brittany, but why do you call everybody lobsters? Are you trying to say listeners?
Is there a joke that I'm not getting? I don't. Okay, look. It's just something that I like to say, okay? Now, I don't know why, but it just is. So, back off, Buster.
Flower and Associates. You look like you could use some consulting. Well, call me now at receive a free consulting session and 15 pounds of trapezoiditis, all for free. I need some business. Real bad. I'm struggling. My wife's about to throw me out. But anyway, this is Don Flower of Don Flower and Associates. Business consultant of the future. Global internet synchronicity. My wife likes it when I call her daddy in bed. I guess she doesn't talk to him much. I'm struggling. I need some business. Real bad. Flower.
Okay, and we're opening back up the phone lines, asking the question, is milk the old-fashioned way better, or do you prefer the new milk? Lobster 5. Wait, is it Lobster 5 or is it Lobster 6? Lobster 5 or 6. Thanks for joining us. What do you think?
Well, personally, I agree with you, Brittany. I love
what I like to call vintage milk. Vintage milk? I like that. I'm going to steal it from you.
Go right ahead. I do have one question.
Sure. Let's keep it about milk.
Well, I was wondering, given your knowledge of all things milk and milk adjacent, would critics describe your first album as homogenized Lolita bubblegum pop? What did that mean to you? Did you take it as a compliment, as I would have? Or did it bother you because it jumbled up your two very, very different professional worlds?
That is a good question, and I will answer it, because it is vaguely milk-related.
I will answer that question.
When critics described my first album as homogenized, I was genuinely confused.
Oh, sorry, I dropped my navel ring.
What does my music have to do with milk production, I'd ask? Or bubblegum? Or soda? Or Vladimir Nabokov? Eventually, someone informed me that homogenization within the sphere of music criticism carries an intensely negative connotation. Rather than alluding to a positive aspect of milk production, homogenization, used in a critical evaluative context, signifies sameness and monotony. Sameness and monotony.
Sameness and monotony.
Two of my not favorite things. Obviously, homogenization is a cliche metaphor, but still, when what they meant became clear to me, it hurt. If they would have actually listened to the album, they would have noted a richness and robustness of variety and sincerity between tracks, thanks to the talent of my wonderful team of songwriters. Oh well, critics kill what they touch. Like bug collectors. I took the reference to Lolita as a clumsy compliment, though. Of course, I could have cried perversion on the part of my critics, but Nabokov has been one of my favorite authors since middle school. Don't believe me? I have a butterfly tattoo on my ankle. That should tell you something.
I doubt anyone cares about this anymore, but in the days before social media, most of Justin Timberlake's and my relationship centered on long nights arguing over certain puzzling passages of that novel. Ay, Lolita, light of my life, fire of my loins, the tip of the tongue taking a trip of three steps. Oops, I've done it again. You haven't tuned into this podcast to hear Britney Spears wax lyrical. You've tuned in for practical advice on common milk production mishaps. Okay, we've gone from the receiving room to the bastardization room to the homogenization room. Next is the bottle washing room. Yay!
Before shipment, bottled milk is stored in the cold room. The cold room must at all times remain cold, hence the name. If it's not cold in there, it's not the cold room. Makes sense? I think so, lobsters. But it also has to remain cold in order to prevent spoilage and preserve the effects of pasteurization. And of course, the utility room contains all the necessary behind-the-scenes gadgets, gizmos, gears, and gewgaws it takes to run a milk production factory or facility.
Yes, Brittany, we all know what a milk plant looks like. Get to the extraction of digital devices from key nodes in the process lines already.
Okay. I just wanted to orient any listeners who may be considering a career in the milk industry to know what a milk factory looks like so they can envision what they might be getting themselves into. And hey, we could all use a refresher now and then, right?
Speaking of refreshment, I'm going to take a break from the Britney Spears Milk Production Facility Repair Guide Hour to pour myself a nice, tall, cool glass of freshly pasteurized, vitamin D fortified whole milk from my local grocer, Tom Dugan.
Meanwhile, here's an important message from a sponsor of today's episode, Star H Equine Insurance. At Star H Equine Insurance, we are knowledgeable horse people with over 45 years of horse insurance experience and are dedicated to helping you with your horse and horse farm insurance needs. We are licensed in all states but Alaska. We offer competitive quotes for your horse mortality and your equine major medical insurance, personal equine liability, and commercial general liability coverages to fit your equine activities. We have them. Call today for more information. 1-877-321-4210. Do you own a horse farm? Whether you have a large commercial equine operation or a small gentleman's horse farm, we will find the right fit for you. Call or email Star H Equine Insurance for a free quote today. 1-877-321-4210. Or you can email me at info@starhinsurance.com.
Ah. That was a nice glass of milk I enjoyed from my local dairy. I hope you enjoyed those nice words of a horse from Star H Equine Insurance. The H stands for horse. Now that we've experienced a sketch of a typical milk plant, let's delve into the design of industrial milk process lines. Depending on applicable legislation and regulatory policies, designs vary from country to country, even from dairy to dairy. For example, fat standardization may be executed in batch before pasteurization or online, where the standardization system is integrated into a pasteurization unit. To save time, let's forego discussion of any arcane legislative or policy details and instead outline a schematic of a representative milk production facility process line. This is not meant to be the platonic ideal or anything, but an ad hoc template to get us through the hour. Your milk process line may vary. Raw milk enters the process line at, you guessed it, the receiving vat. Since you're always supposed to keep the cover on the vat except when in use, you probably won't have much opportunity to drop your phone into it. But if you do, it's usually pretty easy to get to if it hasn't advanced in the line yet. Just make sure no one's looking and reach in. After the receiving vat comes the milk pump. The milk pump forces milk through the sanitary piping toward the pasteurization vat. The pasteurization vat employs an airspace heater assembly made up of a steam strainer, a control valve, a condensation leg with steam trap, an auxiliary water trap, and a steam gauge, all airtight to ensure Justin Timberlake doesn't enter the process line. The space between the insulated outer wall and the inner wall of the pasteurizer forms a water jacket. The water is heated by steam in a mixing valve before it enters the vat. The water jacket is filled up to the overflow pipe. The milk enters the vat through an overhead inlet pipe, filling the vat to a level just below the level of the water jacket to ensure all of the milk is heated. Very important! The agitator stirs the milk to provide uniform heating. All of the bacteria must be exposed to the pasteurizing temperature for pasteurization to take place. From there, an outflow valve allows the pasteurized milk to be whisked away through an outflow pipe and advanced to the rest of the process line.
There is no castration fear. In a chair, you will be with me. We'll dance, we'll dance, we'll dance. Blame stops until you. Stops until you do. Do your major duty and crawl right back again. Time gets to me and I. The heir apparent just might try. You know you should be winning. Time won't wait for you.
Pavement for that first song, and then Stephen Malkmus and the Jicks for the second one. It's a real Malkmus morning over here in the Britney Spears Milk Production Facility Repair Guide Hour. Okay, now that we've gone this far, let's troubleshoot our first scenario. Oops, I did it again. I've dropped my cell phone or smartwatch into the pasteurizer. Before doing anything, take a deep breath. You got this, girl. You got this, girl. You got this, girl. You got this, girl. Disengage the agitator motor and shaft. This will cause the milk and your device to come to a complete stop. If you're lucky, it is simply lying on the bottom of the pasteurizer. In that case, it will be easy peasy mac and cheesy to retrieve. Using a pool skimmer, dredge the bottom of the pasteurizer. Run the skimmer up the side of the vat, occasionally, to see whether you've snagged the item in question. Be careful. The milk is very hot. Near boiling. Do not come in contact with the milk or you will be in the hospital faster than you can say.
Let's agree to disagree. Please.
If your cell phone or smartwatch has advanced to the outflow pipe, things could get tricky. In all likelihood, your device has become stuck in the outflow valve pocket, which is about the size of a locomotive bell and connects the outflow pipe to the pasteurization vat. A cell phone's dimensions will naturally make it more likely that the phone will come to rest in the valve pocket rather than enter the much narrower outflow pipe. A smartwatch, however, is just as likely to pass on through as to stick in the valve pocket. If your device is in the valve pocket, simply reach in from the top of the pasteurization vat and grab it, wearing sanitary gloves, of course. If the device has entered the actual outflow pipe, you need to remove the entire pipe from the line, which could suspend milk production for 2 to 3 hours or more. Sorry, lobsters. Sorry, lobsters. Sorry, 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 lobsters. Once you've removed the outflow pipe, wait for it to cool down. Once it's cooled to room temperature, or to a temperature that will not cause pain or injury, press your eye to the opening to make visual confirmation of the device. Be sure to look from each side of the pipe. You may not be able to see the cell phone or smartwatch clearly, but you should be able to tell by the angle and intensity of the light whether something denser than milk has become obstructed. That's the same kind of technology we use to discover faraway planets. Using a pipe cleaner or chimney sweep brush, vigorously scrub inside of the pipe until you dislodge the device. Finally, reattach the pipe to the pasteurization vat via the outflow valve pocket and do not drop your cell phone or smartwatch into the milk line anymore.
To retrieve your device, make sure you are small enough to get in and out of the process line quickly. You don't want to die just because you dropped your cell phone into milk. Yeah, a lot of people in the industry would consider that a hero's death. But it's still death. And it's time for another sponsorship break. Nothing pairs better with a nice, tall, cool glass of milk than freshly baked, industrial packaged, mass-produced chocolate chip cookies, like the kind Grandma used to make after retirement, into her old age, because Social Security was not enough. Here's a word from Otis, the cookie can-do people.
I like to talk in different voices. I don't have a normal voice. That's okay. That's okay. That's okay.
You're just a girl from Iowa. What do you know, Grandma? Can I have some chocolate chip cookies? Can I have some chocolate chip cookies? Right now, right now. Chocolate chip cookies, Grandma.
Thank you to our sponsor, Otis, for that message. The O stands for Otis. Anyway, like I was saying, reattach the pipe to the pasteurization vat via the outflow valve pocket, and do not drop your cell phone or smartwatch into the milk line anymore. I cannot stress that enough. I know, it's hard. I've been there. But we are milk professionals, and we need to act like it. Milk processing may resume as soon as the outflow pipe is securely attached. Oops.
Oops. Oops.
I was checking my email near the partial homogenizer when I dropped my phone into the milk, and it got stuck.
That's what you sound like.
Or, uh-oh, I forgot to fasten my smartwatch tightly to my wrist, and when I went to take a selfie at the partial homogenizer, the wristband came undone, and my watch went right into the milk. What do I do? We have all been there, folks.
We have all been there.
There are a few simple fixes, depending on where exactly the phone or watch has become obstructed within the homogenizer. First, make sure to disconnect the homogenizer from the main milk line. This means milk production will have to shut down temporarily. Therefore, you may want to try this after hours when the milk line is already disabled. Or get yourself an understanding boss. You will have to follow your factory or facility's guidelines for suspending milk progress along the entire line. Most homogenizers, however, are fairly similar and easy to turn off, thanks to the dedicated shutoff valve, of course. The valve can usually be found near the vat spin speed control console.
Britney Spears, where's the vat spin speed control console?
You ask? Well, I'll tell you. Models from 2010 onwards are usually operated digitally by a smart tablet or computer, so find something that looks like an iPad, and that's probably it. If your homogenizer was produced between 1995 and 2009, the vat spin speed control console is located about 2 feet to the left or right of the forcer, and the shutoff valve is usually enclosed in a glass case directly beneath the console. Or it may be freestanding. It all depends. This is milk production, people. Expect the unexpected. And if your homogenizer is older than 1995, get a new one, Grandpa. But Brittany, what do I do if it's not the homogenizer I've clogged, but the pasteurizer? Whoa, whoa, whoa. Slow down, fella. I already talked about pasteurization earlier in the episode. You should have been listening. But I love milk, so I'll say it again. Retrieving your cell phone or smartwatch from a pasteurizer is very similar to retrieving your cell phone or smartwatch from a homogenizer, with a few key differences. I know I don't have to tell y'all this, but even more important than not dropping your cell phone into the milk line is, of course, preventative maintenance.
You bastard!
What's the use of a freely flowing process line if it's just a sprung bolt away from plant-wide disaster?
Answer, there is none.
Here's a word on preventative maintenance from another one of our sponsors, the U.S. Office of Education and Sanitary Engineering Division of the U.S. Public Health Service, a division of the Federal Security Agency.
According to newcomer, preventive maintenance in developing countries is a procedure involving planning and scheduling, proper installation, periodic inspection, planned lubrication, adjustment of machines and instruments, lubrication repairs and performance of equipment, keeping an adequate supply of spare parts, determining maintenance costs, cleaning and painting equipment and buildings, inspection and maintenance of all emergency personnel and plant protective equipment, maintaining full serviceability of all utilities,
The obvious benefits of preventive maintenance include less production interruptions, fewer large-scale repairs, less raw material and product spoilage, identification of items with high maintenance costs leading to investigation and correction of causes such as misapplications, operator abuse, or obsolescence, better spare parts control, greater work safety, and lower manufacturing costs. Thank you. Now back to the
maintenance spares.
Okay, we've got time for just a few more questions, and then we gotta say goodbye to this episode of the Britney Spears something something whatever. You know what it is.
Hey Britney, is it true that you have like Marxist sentiments now? And you're like some total badass babe radical?
Yes. Next lobster.
So what's the deal with your conservatorship and all that weirdness that has been going on with your parents?
I don't want to talk about it, okay? You've seen the news. This is my one sanctuary from that shit, so please, do not ask. I don't mean to be harsh, but seriously.
Okay, last lobster.
Hey Brittany, when's your next album coming out?
Probably in a couple months, I don't know, whatever.
Well, it's been a wild ride, y'all. Check us out in July for our next topic. If you seek Amy, rescuing your adopted son or daughter from a separator or holding tube. Some information contained in today's podcast comes from the Milk Processors Association Milk Processing Handbook 2012 Revised Edition. You may purchase your own copy of the MPH Revised Edition wherever books relating to milk or milk production are sold. Partial support for the Britney Spears Homogenized Milk Production Facility Repair Guide Hour has been generously provided by the Tim and Rebecca Van Durgenberg Family Charitable Foundation of Oshkosh, Wisconsin, along with Jive Records, a subsidiary of BMG. See you next month, lobsters!
Let's agree to disagree. Please.